welcome to Oneness Pentecostal Tabernacle, the ministry that serves and keeps. In response to the prevailing pandemic, please note the following changes in the operation until further notice. Sundays, we will have Sunday school via live stream Zoom at 9 a.m. We will have Sunday service via live stream at 10 a.m. To connect your child slash teen to our virtual Sunday school ministry at 9 a.m., send an email to Michael Williams at michael.williams@oneness.nyc for our age-specific Zoom connections. If you need prayer, please send us your prayer request at prayforme@oneness.nyc, facebook.com/oneness.ny, or oneness.nyc/contacts. To have someone pray with you live anytime during the message or immediately after the message, please call our teleconference line below. To partner with us financially, please use any of our giving options below. To partner with us in prayer, please call our prayer line using the information below. Mondays to Saturdays at 8 p.m. to 9 p.m., except Wednesday's prayers at 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. This Wednesday, our Bible study lesson will be Eternally Hopeful. People of all walks of life can moor their hopes in this life and beyond to Christ, because Christ reigns supreme over all things in time and eternity. Please tune into our broadcast via our website and media pages at 8 p.m. at oneness.nyc/streaming-video, facebook.com/oneness.ny, or youtube.com/c/oneness.ny/featured. Join the youth ministry this Friday night for an edifying and entertaining youth movie night. Details of the movie and Zoom link will be communicated directly to the parents. Khalil for the People Foundation hosts a food pantry every Wednesday from noon to 5 p.m. to benefit our seniors at the American Legion Post 483, located at 240-08 135th Avenue in Rosedale, New York. They take proper safety precautions when distributing the food and welcome anyone who needs food and even those who would like to help with distribution. The Department of Citywide Administrative Services has several employment opportunities available and is accepting applications for the civil service exams for said jobs. Please visit their website at nyc.gov/exam4jobs to submit your online application for the examinations and job. Do not delay, apply today. The media ministry is looking for volunteers who desire to continue to learn, who are team players, and most of all, committed to ministry. We are looking for those who have a learning aptitude and the willingness to be led. Volunteers will be trained for specific technology skills or knowledge required. Responsibilities include camera streaming operators, audio mixing board specialists, computer graphics technicians, and photographers. To learn more about this ministry, please contact Minister Lewis Maximin at lewis.maximin@oneness.nyc. If you are viewing our video, you reside in New York City, and are looking for a home church, text the words Count Me In or I Want to Join to 347-862-9261 or email us at prayforme@oneness.nyc and someone will contact you as soon as possible. Please pay attention to our website and social media for updates and information as we respond to COVID-19. Also, remain attentive to precautionary measures from federal, state, and city officials. We pray that everyone will do their due diligence to keep themselves and family safe, while we trust God to protect us from those things beyond our control. God bless you.
Welcome to Oneness, where we serve and keep and love everybody. Have your liberty in Jesus. He'll make you the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Joy is here, peace is here, everything you need. Welcome, welcome, welcome to Oneness.
Are you ready to praise Him? We're going to give Him every praise because He's worthy of all of our praises. Hallelujah. Sing every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Father, whatever situation is going on in your life, I just want you to trust God and just watch Him move. The Bible says, faith without works is dead. He that cometh to God must believe. So we're going before God right now, believing that He's going to answer and He's going to supply that need that we have. Whatever it is, Father, right now as we pray, Lord, we come before Your presence, God. We thank You for Your love. We thank You for Your faithfulness. Oh God, we ask You, Lord, move every hindrance, everything, oh God, that will block, oh Father, Your presence from flowing through us, oh God. We ask You, oh God, hide it under Your blood right now. Cover it, wash it, make us pure before You right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray, oh God, over that family. We pray over that situation right now. We pray over that young man, over that young woman. Ask You right now, God. Supply the needs right now, Jesus. We pray for comfort. We pray for deliverance. We pray for healing in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank You right now, oh God, for dispatching Your angels, oh God, of covering and of protection, oh God, about our families, about, oh Father God, everything that's concerning us, oh God. We thank You right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, let Your will be done right now. Let Your kingdom come. Your power and Your glory manifest, Lord, in that situation. In the name of Jesus, Your will, Lord God, we thank You right now, in Jesus' name. Move upon the rest of the services, oh Father God. Let Your will be done in it, oh God. Touch, Lord God, the preacher. Touch, oh Father God, the service. Let every person hear what You got to say, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Your will, Lord, that's what we desire.
Soul, and forget not all His benefits. This morning, I especially want us to grab hold of one of those benefits, and it's because we are the children of God. The Word of God says, for as many as received Him, to them gave He the power to become the sons of God. We are partakers now of the covenant of the promises. We are no longer hopeless and godless. We are no longer strangers and foreigners, but we are fellow citizens with the saints of God. We are part of the household of God. So when you sing this song, sing with the understanding that you are a child of God. Hallelujah.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Know His love for me.
Yes, His love for me.
Who the Son?
Who the Son sets free?
Is free indeed.
Oh, is free indeed.
We are children of the Most High God.
At last He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me.
Yes, He died for me.
So declare,
who the Son sets free.
Oh, we're free indeed.
Verse again, because it says,
who am I that the highest King would welcome me? While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me.
Yes, He died for me.
Who the Son sets free.
Oh, I'm free indeed.
Oh,
free indeed. I'm a child.
Oh, to yourself.
In my Father's house.
Declare that there's a place for you.
For me.
I'm a child of God.
Yes, I
just say it one more time. In my Father's house.
In my Father's
there's
house.
A place for me. Hallelujah.
I'm a child of God.
Yes, I am.
Yes, I am.
Oh, for I am chosen.
I am chosen.
Not forsaken.
I am
who you say I am. You are
for me.
Not against me. I am who you say I am. I am
chosen.
Not forsaken. Because I am. For me, not against me.
I am who you say I am.
I am who you say I am.
I am who you say I am.
Oh, yes, I am.
I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free.
Oh, declare that you are free indeed. Free from fear. Free from anxiety. Free from worry. In my Father's house,
in my Father's house,
there's a place for me.
Yes. Of the covenant of promises. We have an inheritance,
yes,
kept in heaven for us.
Yes.
It's incorruptible. It's undefiled. It faded not in my Father's house.
It's free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child.
Jesus, we give you all the honor. We give you all the glory. How great thou art. Hallelujah. 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 I thank you, Jesus.
Now we're entering a time of giving. For those who don't know, we have 5 ways of giving here at OPT. Download the app from your smartphone or tablet and select OPT. Select the program and the amount you wish to contribute and hit give. It's easy as 1, 2, 3, or tap, tap, give. Our other option, text to give, is now available by texting GIVE to 844-946-2077. Others can continue to give by check or cash. Checks can be mailed to OPT at P.O. Box 502, St. Albans, New York, 11412, or simply drop off at the office, which is located at 19801 Linden Boulevard. Our office hours are Tuesdays through Friday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Here at OPT, we have a pledge which we recite when we receive our offering. Even though you may be at home, we invite you to join us as we recite our pledge.
Upon the authority of your word, I have given, and it shall be given back to me. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over, I am a giver. I bring my tithes, offerings, and alms today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked, and the curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there's not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises, bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts demolished, royalties received, my whole family saved and walking with God, perfect health and abundance to walk in divine favor. I command the enemy to pay back sevenfold of all the things he has stolen from me. This day I shall recover all without fail. For I am blessed going in and I am blessed going out. And all that I do will prosper in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise the Lord. I'm so glad that I have a Savior who is truly my defense. He is my shield and my hiding place. And we're so grateful this morning that we know Him and we can call on Him in time of trouble. Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God.
Now, O Lord, are a shield.
You're my shield, O Lord.
My glory, you lift my head.
Cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. I laid me down and I slept. I awaked for the Lord sustained me.
But thou, O Lord, are a shield for me.
You're my glory,
my
Lord.
Glory.
I will not be afraid of 10,000 of people that set themselves against me round about.
I will never be afraid.
I will not be afraid of 10,000
of the terror by night.
That set themselves
God,
against me
for
round
thou
about.
Are a shield for me.
Thou, oh Lord,
yes,
are a shield for me.
God, you're my glory.
My head.
But thou, O Lord,
thou, O
glory.
You're my glory.
My glory.
We're going to declare it one more time. We will never be afraid.
But thou, oh Lord,
are a shield.
For me.
You're my glory.
My glory. You lift my head.
You're my
me.
Glory.
My glory.
And I'm going to say it again. I will never be afraid. Hey.
I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people
that set themselves
against me round
about. I'm not going to be quiet. I'm not going to be silent.
I will not be afraid.
I'm going to stand. I'm going to stand in the face of the enemy and declare that my God is a shield for me.
Thou, oh Lord,
yes,
are a shield for me.
You're my glory.
My glory. You lift my head.
Yeah. Hey.
Thou, oh Lord, are a shield.
You're my glory.
My glory.
You're my glory. Yes.
For me.
I can call on
my
you
glory,
in my weakness,
my
in my despair. Thou, oh Lord,
thou, oh Lord, are a shield for me.
You're my glory.
My glory, the lifter up of my head.
Thank you for lifting. Thank you for lifting. Thank you for lifting my head. Say,
thank you for lifting
when I cry.
Thank you for lifting
in despair.
Thank you for lifting my head.
Oh,
thank you for lifting
when I couldn't find the answer.
Thank you for lifting.
I could lean on your word.
My head.
Thank you for lifting my head when we're hurting.
Thank you for lifting.
Our heart is hurting.
Thank you for lifting.
Our heart's in pain.
Head.
We're struggling, Lord,
thank
but thank you. We're in pain, Lord,
thank
but thank you. It's hard right now,
thank
but thank you for lifting my head. But thou,
oh Lord,
are a shield
for me.
You're my glory.
My glory. You lift my head.
My mind says thank you. My heart says thank you. Thank you for lifting my
We worship you, Jesus. right where you are at home, why don't you just lift your hands right here in the presence of God? We're getting ready to get into the word of the Lord right now. But if you just lift those hands right where you are, God's presence, God's spirit is even ministering to you in your home right now, in your car, in your office, wherever that space is. Feel God's presence that is in this room right now beginning to radiate through where you are. And just lift those hands and say, Lord, I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. I know that my life is not my own, God. And I give you praise. I give you honor. I give you glory. Great God of the heavens. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. It feels good just to worship the Lord, doesn't it? It feels good just to feel the caress of God's presence upon our souls. Oh, I worship you, Jesus. Magnify your great name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you one more time for joining our service and for staying with us to this point. And I believe that God has a word that he has prepared for us to receive today, to speak to every situation that we might be concerned about in this hour. If you haven't done so yet, go on and share this video with a friend right now. Invite somebody to watch this word of God, because I do believe that God has given a word that will speak to us in this hour. We thank God for that right now. Hallelujah. If you would like to partner with us financially, we have outlined some ways below that you can share with us. Just pray and ask God how you can come alongside us in this time of ministering to the needs of so many people in this hour. And please feel free. The links are below right here in the lower third of the screen. They're being displayed how you can partner with us in that way. And we also want to partner with you as we always want to do in prayer. And so at any time in this message, please feel free. There'll be a number that is being displayed in the lower third of your screen. 347-862-9261. Please feel free to call that number, and we would love to pray with you. We would love to walk with you to the throne of grace. I know you can do it by yourself. You don't need a middle person, but sometimes we all need a person to come alongside us and help us to pray. So please feel free to call us at any time during this message, this word of God. Why don't you bow your heads with me right now as we're getting ready to enter into the word of God right now, and let us just pray and ask God just to speak to us out of the volume of his book. Father, we thank you, Jesus. One more time, we praise you, we adore you. You have allowed us to live to see this another day, and for this we are eternally grateful. Words are insufficient to express the gratitude we feel in our hearts that we are still here. The middle of the year and we're still here. The second half and we're still here, praising and glorifying your name, still alive in the land of the living. Now we ask you, God, to release word to us, God, that we might continue standing in strength. Standing, Lord God, in your word, being scaffolded and upheld thereby. I pray that out of this word that you'll comfort hearts and souls, convict us, Lord God, that we might draw closer to you. Save us, transform us, and give us hope, renewed hope. In you we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Once again, God bless you, and thank you so much for joining us in our Sunday service. We're glad that you've taken the time out to share in this virtual worship. Thank you, Minister Mark. Amen. Why don't you go with me in your Bibles today to the book of Psalm chapter 46. Psalm chapter 46, and I'll be working my way through this particular chapter today. Psalm chapter 46. I will not read it ahead of the message, but I'll work the verses into this message. I'd ask you just to grab your Bibles, your smart devices, open that Bible app, keep it open all through the message, and let's work our way through this particular word that I feel like God has laid in my spirit to minister to us this day. I want to talk to us from Psalm 46, verses 1 to 11, and I want to speak to us on the thought, God reigns. Yeah, and a smile crept over my heart and over my face when I reminded myself in this season that God reigns. And I hope that it brings the same effect to your life, to your world right now, when you think about the fact that our God still reigns. Our God is still in control. Our God is still awesome and still magnificent. One of the questions that is on the lips of everyone in this season that we're in right now is this: what are all our current events saying to us? How are we to make sense of all that is happening around us? There are some that are asking the question, is the world about to end? And yet for others, there is the question of, is God still in control given the mayhem, the chaos, the upheavals that are happening all around us in our world? To be sure, we are experiencing multiple current and concurrent crises within our world, so much so that it might seem to us that this is the end of our world, or we are nearing the end of our world as we know it. Our circumstances look like the kind of apocalypse that Jesus himself had talked about and educated his disciples about in Matthew chapter 24, verses 1 to 14. And I'm not in a hurry today. I just want to take my time and have a discussion with us around this word of God. Jesus did say to his disciples that when we are nearing the end of this world, that we'll hear of wars and threats of wars. There'll be political posturing among nations and within nations. There'll be famine and droughts. There'll be global disasters and diseases, such as what we're experiencing right now, even experiencing COVID-19. There'll be an increase in false prophets, and we're seeing that today. Pimps in the pulpit, we might want to call them by that new name. There'll be lawlessness and violence, which he describes as the mystery of iniquity. There'll be a loss of natural affection, the rights and the freedoms of the church being gradually stripped away from us. There'll be apostasy, people falling away from the faith. And if you are paying attention to your news feed, if you are paying attention to what is going on around us right now, that there are prominent people of faith who in recent times have fallen away. There is one very prominent Christian singer who in the month of May decided that he wanted to announce to the world that he's becoming atheistic because he can't believe in a God that is in control of this world, but yet allow racial tensions to happen. He can't believe in a God who is still in control of this world, but yet allows a pandemic to sweep and to change our world in the way that we've seen in recent times. He cannot believe that there is a God and all the atrocities are going on around us in the world, and God does not publicly intervene. But I'm here today to say to him and to others who might be pondering the same question, I want to say to us today, hang with us for a little while here, because I want to remind us that God still reigns. God still reigns. We will have to go through great tribulation and tribulations within our time. I don't believe the church will go through the great tribulation, and there's another subject for another time, but we will go through some problems. The Lord did say in this world we will have some tribulations. We will have some pressuring circumstances. Everything will not always be easy. We'll all go through some difficult and trying times. But we've got to understand this here, brothers and sisters, and whoever is viewing right here, we've got to understand this, that God is still in control. And to these questions that people are asking, what is going on around us? Are we near the end of time? Are these the signs of the end of time? And there's a lot of questions. I hear the questions too. And we cannot say with any kind of certainty that God is coming at any specific date. We cannot assert that the coronavirus pandemic or the political upheaval will usher in the coming of the Lord. All that we can do is to parrot the saying of Jesus to his disciples, where he says to them, these things are going to happen. The things that you're seeing around you right now, the diseases, the disagreements, the discord, the loss of love and natural affection, the lawlessness. He said these things will happen, but we've got to realize that these turbulences of our present age, they are not necessarily the end in themselves, but they are certainly the birth pangs to reveal to us that somehow the end is near. The end is near. And even good doctors will tell you this. They know that the birth pangs only give an idea, but not the absolute measure of the end of the pregnancy. But what they will tell you is that once you begin to feel the birth pangs, you need to present yourself in the place where you are ready to give birth. You're ready to produce. You're ready for the end of the pregnancy. So what I want to say to us here is we don't know for certain what all of these things mean. All I can do is try to speak to them from the Word of God, but I can't give a definitive answer to those who have questions as to whether this is the end or not. But I want to say to us that just in case we are nearing the end, and I feel like we're nearing the end, the best place for us to be is in the kingdom of God. You ought to tell somebody that right now. The best place to be is in the kingdom of God. The best place to be right now is in the church, because in this time, the church is the manifest evidence of God's kingdom. The best place to be is in the church, because God is still reigning over everything, and as a church of the Lord, we celebrate that, and we keep that at the forefront of our minds. And I'm here to give you hope today as a member of God's kingdom that God is still reigning. God is still on the throne. When we speak concerning the kingdom of God or the reign of God, we've got to embrace this tension that the kingdom is here, but it's not yet fully revealed. Hear me. So God is here. We can feel God in the church. We experience the move of God, the power of God. Anybody's ever experienced the healing of God, amen, you know that God's power is real. Anybody who has ever been blessed by God, provided for by God, felt God's protection, we know that we're in the kingdom of God, but yet still, he will still allow the natural course of the fallen world to play out until the day when he publicly interrupts our government, interrupts our lifestyle, interrupts the flow of our world, and take full control over everything. And at that time, there'll be peace like never was before. But until then, diseases will still come. Wars will still be waged, because that day when God shall take control over everything and exert his power in the world fully is not yet here. So we are walking through some turbulent times. We are walking through some difficult times. We're trotting the valley of uncertainties and adversity. But I'm so glad that God has not left his people without a hope. God has not left his people without a word, because this word right here in Psalm 46, one of those songs of Zion, one of those songs of Israel, was written to celebrate God's presence in God's temple on the holy mountain of God, a presence that promised security and blessing to the people of God in the middle of a time when their enemies were surrounding them. In the middle of a time when they were going through all kinds of atrocity and difficulties and adversity, but they could document for us Psalm 46 to let us know that no matter what kind of trouble hits our world, our God is still on the throne. God is still on the throne. Somebody ought to celebrate that right now, that our God is still on the throne. We're not sure. We're not sure depending on what commentary you read. There are some who say that this psalm was written by Hezekiah at the time when Assyria had laid siege against the city of Jerusalem. There are others who say that Psalm 46 was written at the time when Jehoshaphat was against the coalition force of the Ammonites and the Moabites and the Mount Syrians. But they are saying that that might have been the time when it was written. We're not sure, but what we do know is it was written at a time when God's people were facing extreme adversity, where there were enemies on every side, difficulties and distresses, which I'll talk about as we're going through this message here. But what we do know is that God had to provide deliverance for his people in the middle of what they were facing, to remind them that no matter what enemy comes against you, no matter what king comes against you, or kings or nations, I am still the king of all kings. I'm still the God who reigns. And at this time when we're facing extreme difficulties and challenges and uncertainties in our lives, I want to raise this word of God from Psalm 46 to let us know that no matter what the situation is that we can find ourselves in now or in the future, God still reigns. Somebody ought to go ahead and type that in the comment section right here. God still reigns. And so from Psalm 46, you know it. I want to make my 4 points to us and get out your way. My 4 points, yeah. I want to make my 4 points to us from Psalm 46. And I want to say to us, first of all, I want us to consider the thesis statement of this particular psalm, that God reigns. And then I want to raise for us from the psalm 2 concrete manifestation that God still reigns, that God is still in control, that God is still powerful and mighty. And then finally, my last point will be a call for God's people to respond to the manifest reign of our God. Anybody ready to jump in? Let's get ready to jump in this word of God right here. So I'm in verse 1, and the thesis statement in verse 1 is this, that is made by the psalmist. It is this: God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Right up front, he wants us to know this: God is our refuge and our strength. Whatever is going on around us, kings against us, armies against us, disease on every side, disasters going on, but he wants us to know up front that God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Here's point number one that I want to leave with us here from this message. It is this: God reigns in our palpable distresses. Here it is one more time. God reigns in our palpable distresses. What are you talking about here, preacher? He says this, that God reigns. God is our refuge and our strength, our very present help in trouble. He's our very present help in trouble. And this word trouble here, it is talking about distresses, but it's not just light distresses. It's a type that is so thick around you, that is so compounded, that it's almost like you can touch it. Anybody ever been there where the troubles around you seem so heavy, it's almost like you could literally feel it? The fears around you, the anxieties around you, the sighings around you was so heavy, it's almost like you could touch it, like you could feel trouble, literally, not as an abstract thing, but you could feel it all up in your world. The palpable distresses of our lives. But he says God still reigns in these things. I mean, when trouble is around you, that it's readily discernible, where it's whelming or overwhelming to you, where you are touched by them. And every time you look around you, you can see the evidence of troubles around you. You can see the evidence that things are not the way they used to be. The very fact that every now and then you turn the TV on and you hear reports about more cases of COVID-19 and more cases of racial issues and more cases of political upheaval and more cases of disasters and wars and rumors of wars around us, the trouble is palpable around us. We feel the distresses of these things, plus the things that we are dealing with in our personal lives. The trouble is palpable. And if we should look at this from the perspective of Hezekiah, for Hezekiah, he was dealing with the defamatory taunts of Rabshakeh, the military general of the Assyrian army. He was dealing with the defamatory taunts where Rabshakeh was saying to them, I'm going to tear your kingdom down. I'm going to tear Jerusalem down. We're coming in there to get you. Don't think that you're safe behind your walls. He was dealing with the fears of his own people. He's dealing with the reality of a siege against his city, where they have built a mound against his city and they're hitting with the battering rams, trying to break the gate down, trying to break the walls of the city down. He's dealing with the knowledge that the sister city Samaria had already been defeated by Assyria. Egypt had already been defeated by Assyria. He was dealing with the fact that there was no help from a human arm around him. The fear, the distresses was palpable in the mind of Hezekiah. And what might that look like for us right now? Because we are also dealing with many palpable distresses around us. The battles that we're fighting right now, sin issues that we're struggling with, personal weaknesses that we're dealing with in our lives, relational breakdown that we are having, emotional fragility from the many uncertainties of our times, the health concerns of COVID-19, the uncertainties of our job situations or our school or life returning to normal. There is a constant constant struggle around us that we're dealing with every day. You turn the news on, you pick the newspaper up, you get on the social media, and we feel the distress of this life that's just breaking in upon us. But I want you to know this right here, right now, that in the middle of palpable distresses, you still have a God who reigns. Hallelujah. You still have a God who reigns. And so he is introduced to us in Psalm 46. He's introduced as God. And as I was reading through the Psalms, I realized that there are several titles that God, by which God is referenced in the Psalm. And what do they mean to us here? Up front, the writer calls him God, not Lord, not Yahweh, but he calls him God. He calls him the Elohim God, the first title of God here, which shows here the power of our God, because Elohim is the singular God with a plural title. That's why there are many who, when they read these and they read them in the original languages and they see Elohim, they begin to think that it's a plural deity, but they all have to come to the agreement that it's a singular deity, but there is a plural title. Why? Because God has so much power within himself that they got to call this the intensive plural for God, which talks about the fullness of the power of God. And what does that mean for us here? What this means is that God has enough power to deal with every situation that's going on in our lives. Whatever it is that is distressing you, God has enough power to handle that thing in his life. The majestic plural, which indicates that God is the king. God rules and reigns in power. God reigns in the middle of the distresses of our lives. And here is what God wants us to know here. He says, I am your refuge. I am your refuge. I am your place of safety. Because I got all this power, but I don't have all this power just for a show. I don't just have all this power for myself. I am your refuge. I want to use my power to make you feel safe. I want to show you my power so that I might invite you to put your trust in me, because I am the God who will never fail you. Is there anybody who has that testimony right here, right now, that God has never failed and God will never fail, because God has all power within himself? So he says, I am your refuge. But God also says, I am your strength. I'm the God that will be strong for you. When your strength runs out, I got some strength for you. Hezekiah, Egypt is not there for you because they've already been defeated, but I am your strength. Samaria can't help you because they have already been, but Hezekiah, and for us today, he is saying to us, all those whom you could call on, all those whom you could look to, they might not be there for you right now because they got their own issues going on, but God says, hey, I am your strength. I am the one who will be strong for you right now. So I am your refuge. I'm the place you can run to and you can find safety. I am your strength. I'll be strong for you to overcome the temptation. I'll be strong for you to bear the burdens of your life. I'll be strong for you through my grace and the power of my spirit. I'll be strong for you through my word. I'll be strong for you through the fellowship of other saints. I'll be strong for you, said the Lord, but I am also your present help. I am the help that is there for you. I'm readily available when trouble is around you. You need someone to rely on, you can't find anybody, then lean on me, says the Lord. I'll be there for you. I am your present help in trouble. And what does this say to us? Come here for a second. I want you to hear this word. God says, I am your present help, not in the time of trouble, but in trouble. What's the difference here? What this is saying here is, it's almost like God resides in the trouble. Isn't this the God that says, if you make your bed in hell, I'm already there. If you take the wings of the morning and go to the uttermost part of it, I'm already there. Whatever it is, wherever it is that you can find yourself, I'm already there. So is it a surprise then that God is also in our troubles waiting? Wasn't he there in Daniel's lion's den experience before Daniel got there? Oh yeah, he was there and he shut the mouth of the lions before Daniel's foot hit the bottom of the cave. Wasn't he there in the fiery furnace that when the Hebrew boys got in there, he could cool the flame and make sure that they were not? He was already, and I'm here to tell you right now that God is already in every trouble that you can go through. He's already in the one that we're in right now. And God says, I am your present help. So my question to us now is, like I said, I want to talk to us today here. I want to ask us, now that we know that God reigns in our palpable distresses, the ones that you feel all around you, it's so tangible. You feel it so heavily, weighing on your emotions, weighing on your heart, weighing on your mind, weighing on your weighing on your finances. But God says, I am your refuge. I am your strength. I am your very present help in the middle of those situations. So the question is, how do we respond to this God who reigns even in our distresses? Here is the answer. I want you to reach out to God for your help. Because if he's our help, we got to reach out to God for that help. Cry out for your help. Now is not the time for us to be proud or arrogant. Now is a time for us to cry out to God for our help. Reach out to God for the help you need in your family situation. Receive God's strength in your life through his grace and through the Holy Spirit. And sure enough, run into the refuge of God. Run into his name. His name is a strong and a mighty tower, and the righteous run therein and are saved. Run into the name of the Lord and allow the Lord to give you security in this day and in this time when everything else is failing. And hear me now. I want to talk to you right there. I want to talk to you right there as I leave this first point. If you are where you are, wherever it is that you are, emotionally, psychologically, physically, right now, and you have heard this word of God and you feel distressed by sin and you feel distressed by your life circumstances and you want to reach out to God, but you need somebody to come alongside you and pray with you, why don't you pick your phone up right now? Come on, pick that phone up and call us right now at 347-862-9261 or email us at prayforme@oneness.nyc. We would love to help you take that distress that is in your life to the Lord right now. So God reigns in our palpable distresses. But let me move on to point number two here. God also reigns. Here's point number two. So point number one is God reigns. The premise is God reigns. The point number one is God reigns in our palpable distresses. When our troubles that are all around us, he is our present help in the middle of all that. But here's my second point to us here. God also reigns in our potent disasters/diseases. Here it is in Psalm 46 verses 2 to 5. It says this, therefore we will not fear, though the earth gives way. Sounds like a disaster, doesn't it? Though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling, Selah, rest. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when the morning dawns. And I'm reading from the English Standard Version of the Bible here. So what is the situation that he's talking about here? He's talking about a situation where nature is in a tailspin, where there are earthquakes because the mountains are shaking and about to give way. There are volcanoes. There might be tsunamis because it talks about the mountains moved into the heart of the sea. And we know what happens when water is displaced by landmass falling in. There might be floods and tornadoes and diseases to boot. And we are dealing with all of these things right now in our reality. But I want us to know that God reigns even in our most potent disasters and diseases. What did it look like for Hezekiah in his time? For Hezekiah, he saw the siege and the bulwarks that were laid against the wall of the city. He heard the battering rams trying to knock down the walls of Jerusalem and to break the gates down. His whole world seemed like it was shaking at that time, so to speak. Because whenever ancient cities were under siege, I mean, the army would surround the city. They'd put the battering rams and they'll try to break the walls down. It's almost like between the noise of the soldiers and the clanging of their shields and their swords and the battle cries and the battering rams and all that they were doing, it's almost like his entire world was topsy-turvy. His entire world was shaken up. And does anybody feel like right now everything that can be shaken in our world has been shaken? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. But if that was not enough, he's dealing with the mountain shaking. But what also happens whenever there is a siege in the ancient world is that the enemies would disrupt their supply of food and water. So they could not have running water, neither would they have food resources. So now what begins to happen is, and people are dying in the city, so now disease and infections usually begin to break out in the city because of the confinement and the inability to practice proper sanitation. And sometimes, while they had to end up consuming for food out of real hunger, and famine would also cause disease among the people. So they were dealing with all of these things in their day and in their time. And Hezekiah says, or whoever it is that wrote this psalm out of that experience, says that God still reigns. Hear me, in the middle of our potent disasters and diseases. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost helping me right here. Somebody ought to go ahead and tap them in the comment section right here, that God still reigns in the middle of our potent disasters / diseases. What does that look like for us in our time? I want you to hear me right now. I want you to consider with these what's going on with me, what's going on in our day and in our time. We are having unprecedented disasters, natural disasters, microorganismic disasters around us, and diseases going on around us right now in our world. Let me just run a few for us right here. Right now, there are swarms of locusts that are raging in Africa and in certain Eastern African countries, including Kenya and Somalia and Ethiopia and somewhere in Asia and in the Middle East, like Yemen and Saudi Arabia and Sudan and Uganda and Iran. Those places are right now under the scourge of a plague of locusts. I'm telling you that we're dealing with diseases and disasters in our time. There, and just a few days ago, we were dealing, and there's still remnants of it right now in the air, we were dealing with the Sahara dust drift, where an expansive plume of dust from the Sahara Desert traveled westward across the Atlantic Ocean, reaching the Caribbean and parts of the United States. And a lot of these things we miss in the news mill because of all that is going on around us. We are bombarded on every side. We had an earthquake in Puerto Rico and in the Caribbean in the spring. Over 6,000 tornadoes that came through the Dixie Tornado Alley between April and June. We're dealing with the coronavirus pandemic across the globe that has severely curtailed our way of life and our livelihood. There is Ebola virus resurgent in the Congo. There is measles epidemic in Burundi. There is Middle East respiratory syndrome coronavirus in Saudi Arabia. There is a yellow fever outbreak in Gabon. And meanwhile, we're going through all of these. There is famine and drought in Zimbabwe and in South Sudan and in Congo and in Haiti and some places in Central America. It's almost as if all of the mountains of our security are trembling right now, almost as though they're getting ready to break. And I don't know what you are dealing with in your personal life, but you can add that to the list of all the things that are going on around us right now. It would seem like everything is getting ready to break, but the psalmist says, Selah. Hallelujah. That is, we ought to pause and think about all that is going on. And then above that, he then says, I want you to remember that there is a river. Hallelujah. The streams whereof shall make glad the city of God. In other words, what he's saying is, in the middle of all of these potent disasters and diseases that is rocking our world, remember that there is still a refreshing resource called our God. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah right where you are right now. Now, you ought to text this to somebody, type this in the comment section, tweet this out there. Let them know that in the middle of potent disasters, God still reigns. God still reigns. And I want you to hear right here that God still reigns because God is still our provision in the middle of all of these things. For Hezekiah, God provided an underground stream that supplied them with water even while the battering rams were still on the outside. And how many can testify right here that God has brought about a stream in your life? Yeah, he's brought about a new stream of prayer in your life. Since you've been locked down, you've been praying praying more than you ever prayed, that there's a new stream of prayer in your life. There's a new stream of refreshing in your life. There's a new spiritual stream. There's a new emotional stream. Your relationships have never been better since you've got more time on your hands now. But also in the middle of a pandemic, God has given you new streams of income and ways of earning. Am I talking to anybody right here who can testify that God still reigns in our disasters and in our diseases? Go ahead and type it in the comment section right here that I know God reigns in the middle of disease and disasters. God reigns. Hallelujah. God reigns in provision. But Hezekiah says, not only does God reign in provision in the middle of these things, but God reigns in presence. We are conscious of the nearness of our God. Here is what he says. He says, God is in the midst of her. You've got to know this right here, that God is still in the middle of our country. Yes, he is. I said it. God is still in the middle of our country. No matter what's going on, he is still in the middle of our earth. He is still in the middle of our church. He is still in the middle of our lives. I'm telling you right here, right now, God is still right in the midst. Somebody ought to embrace the presence of God in your house, in your life right now, because God's presence is still here in spite of all that's going on. So God's provision reminds us that God reigns. God's presence reminds us that God reigns. But God's permanence also reminds us that in the middle of disasters and distresses and diseases, God still reigns. He says this, though the earth be removed. You got to hear me now. What he's alluding to is, even though the earth be removed, God is not moved. And if we stay in God, neither will we be moved. If God does not move, and if we stay in God, you can hear me, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord, because we know that our labor is not in vain. Why? Because God is permanent. God does not move. But so God, there's God's provision, there's God's presence, there's God's permanence, but there's God's posture. He says this, hear this, that even though the mountains be shaken, and the allusion is that even though the mountains be shaken, God is never shaken. Finance is shaken, but God isn't shaken. Health department is shaken, but God isn't shaken. Security is shaken, but God still stands aloft in the middle of all of these things, because God is not shaken by earthly circumstances. He is the unmoved mover. He moves things without he himself being moved. So God's provision, God's presence, God's permanence, God's posture, God's prominence, though things may fall, but God still stands above everything. And I hear God speaking into a storm right now, and I hear him saying, peace be still. Oh yeah. He rises above the storms. He looks at the waves and he says, peace be still. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. God is still prominent around us right now, but God's promise is also there. We know God reigns because God is still making. Is there anybody right here that even though you're going through a pandemic, you're still holding on to a promise? Even though things are not the way we want them yet in our country, we're still holding. Is there anybody still holding on to a promise of God right here? Hallelujah. Here's the promise of God. God says, I will help her when the morning dawns. Hallelujah. After a night of hardship, the promise of God is that I will help you. Weeping may endure for a night. You may have to go to the dark night of your soul. You may have to endure a difficult situation for a while. Yeah. But God says, it is not to destroy you. I shall help you when the morning breaks. And you got to hear me now, that morning daybreak may be at different time for different people, depending on where they are. If you check the radar in the morning, they'll tell you what time the sun comes up at different parts of the United States of America, because the sun may raise at different, might come up at some different time. The day may break at some different points for many of us, depending on. But the one thing that we are sure of is God says the day will break, and I will help you when the day breaks. I feel the Holy Ghost right here. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to say, my help is on the way. Come on, go ahead and type it in the comment section right here. I've got a promise from God that my help is on the way. So how do we respond then? If we know that we have a God that is still reigning in the middle of disasters and diseases, how do we respond? Here's my first response to us. It is this. We will not fear. We will not be paralyzed by fear. Somebody ought to go ahead and put it out in the atmosphere right here. We shall not fear. You ought to say it until you believe it. You ought to say it until you feel the boldness arise inside your heart. We shall not fear. We shall not be paralyzed by fear.
We will find joy in God's city, in God's church. Here it is. The city shall be glad, says the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. We will not be moved to despondence, for the word of God says we shall not be moved. Do I have anybody who remember that old song that says, I shall not be moved, just like a tree that is planted by the water. Why don't you raise that song in your house right now, right where you are. Tell somebody, I shall not be moved. Hallelujah. Give yourself a high five in your own house. Say, there's disasters around me. There are diseases around me, but I shall not be moved. Why? Because God still reigns in the middle of it all. We shall not be moved. And it says we will receive God's help. God shall help her. It says we shall receive God's help. I shall receive God's help in the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the great helper whereby God helps our infirmities. And by infirmities here, it means our sins. It means our weaknesses. It means our anxieties. It means our frailties. It means our fears. It means even the diseases that may be in our bodies, of whatever sort it is. The Holy Spirit is our helper. Here it is. Likewise, the Spirit of God helps our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit of God intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. So in other words, what the writer is saying here is that God helps us through the Holy Ghost. And when God puts a Spirit inside of us, there are days when you don't even know what to say, because you don't even know what you're up against, what spirit you're praying against. But the Holy Ghost begin to help you with groanings that are too deep for words, and all you can do is just, do I have anybody who still know how to groan? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Does anybody still know how to groan in the Spirit of God and to find help in the power of God, to remind yourself that even though there are disasters around us, earthquakes and volcanoes in various places around our world, and the disease around us and the global pandemic of corona, but God still reigns in the middle of it all. God still reigns. So here is the deal. As I close the second point, if you need God's Spirit, come on, if you need God's Spirit, I'm talking to you right there. If you need God's Spirit to help you right now, if you need, which one am I on right there? If you need God's Spirit to help you right now, right where you are, what I want you to do is to pick up your phone right now and call us at 347-862-9261. Somebody is waiting to pray with you until the Holy Ghost gets all up in your spirit and begin to help you and to remind you that you are an overcomer. Yeah, until the Holy Ghost gets in you and begin to bring out the image of God in you, to remind you that your God reigns and you've got a part of God on the inside. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah right there. But I got two more points to go. So God reigns, and he reigns in our palpable distresses that are so heavy around us. We can almost feel them, touch them. They are weighing on us. But God also reigns in our potent disasters/diseases. But here is the third point, and please don't tune me out. Don't turn your monitor off just yet. God reigns even in our political disturbances. Somebody is saying, don't go there, Brother Omar. Yes, I'm going to go there. God reigns in our political disturbances. Let's talk about this here. Verses 6 to 7. The nations rage. The kingdoms totter. Hallelujah. But in the middle of all of that, God utters his voice, and the earth has got to melt. Kings have got to sit down somewhere. Why? Because the Lord of hosts, he is with us. And the God of Jacob, he is our fortress. Selah. Pause. And I love this right here. I love this. Let's tiptoe through this right here right quick. The nations rage. And Albert Barnes put this way. He says, the nations were in commotion. They were agitated like restless waves of the sea. Kingdoms were moved through invasion, through coup d'etat, through colonialism, through exile, through slavery, through the marauding Assyrian Empire. And I'm paraphrasing some of it here, adding my own words to it. But here is the deal. And so in Hezekiah's time, nations were apprehensive because the Assyrians were throwing down everybody. They were throwing down everybody. And now they thought that they would subdue Jerusalem like they had subdued every other nation. They said, Jerusalem, you think you will stand when everybody else has fallen to us? So here is the vitriol of Rabshakeh. in Isaiah 36:8-20. It says, beware lest Hezekiah mislead you by saying that the Lord will deliver you. Oh, he should not have sent a threat to our God, because when you begin to threaten our God, he takes that person. You got to hear me right here, right now. He made a mistake. The vitriol of Rabshakeh, because kingdoms were moved by the Assyrians. Who could help Israel's cause? But I'm so glad that when they sent the threatening letter to Hezekiah, and when they began to talk about what they've done to other nations and how they are getting ready to tear down the Assyrians and to tear down their temple and to tear down their God, they made a mistake, because they thought that our God was a God of stone that was limited to a physical space and place. But I'm glad that Hezekiah, when he got the letter, come on, Brother Mark, Hezekiah said, God, this is not my battle. And I wish, can I talk to you? What camera am I on right here? What, can I talk to you right there? Hear me. You ought to know this. The battle is not yours, but it is the Lord. You ought to type that in the comment section right here. Text it to somebody. Tell them the battle is not yours. It is the Lord's. Stop trying to fight it on your own. God allowed coronavirus for a reason. It is to show the world that God is still in control. God is not shaken by all of this. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. Hezekiah brought the letter to God, and he laid it out in the temple. He laid it down in the temple. I'm in Isaiah 37:16-20. And Hezekiah prayed to God a simple prayer that all of us ought to lift up to the Lord right now for ourselves as we are dealing with this season of political disturbances. O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim, you are the God, you alone of all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made the heaven and the earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see and hear all the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to mock the living God. Truly, O Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations and their lands, and they have cast their gods into the fire, for they were no gods but the work of men's hand, wood and stone, therefore they were destroyed. So now, O Lord, our God, hear this, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone are the Lord. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. And what does that look like for us in our time? That was Hezekiah. But what does it look like for us in our time? Right now, internationally, there is political unrest in between so many nations. In Hong Kong, there is political unrest. Within the United States, there are ongoing race-related protests and riots and killings. In the Philippines, there is protest for free speech. In Canada and Israel and Brazil, they're having race-related protests for police killing unarmed minorities and so on. And time would fail me to talk about the political rifts in the European Union. Time would fail me to talk about the tensions in the United Nations. But suffice it to say, the nations are raging and the kingdoms are tottering. And nationally, I feel like preaching in this place right here. Somebody ought to say that the nations are raging, but God is still on the throne. Woo! I feel the Holy Ghost helping me right here. And naturally, come on, I want you to hear me right here. If you want preaching that is not grounded in the reality of our world, then I'm sorry, but I got to ground it right here. Nationally, the church folks in the United States, we are faced with a dilemma of political proportions. When we go to the polls in November this year to elect a president, surely their discourse has been very coarse, because the nations are raging, the kingdoms are tossing against each other. Their speech has been vitriolic, and our concerns are, whose policies can we trust? We're wondering, are they too old? Are the candidates too old to complete a solid 4 years of governance? Who has the godliest values? But can I invite you into something right quick here? God had three problems with national leadership over the years, not just in our time, but over the years. He had an issue with idolatry, pride, and self-reliance. He had an issue with immorality, those who made laws that perverted God's natural order. He had an issue with injustice, those who made laws that preferred some people over other people. Can I talk to us here? Make no mistake about it. Both candidates will have idolatry in their life, because all of them are self-reliant. Can I talk to somebody right here? They may not pray to God to ask God what to do for the good of the nation, for the good of the church, for the good of the people. And one side side may expose us to more immorality, but the other side will expose us to more injustice. So we're wondering, who do we choose? And while I say to us, vote responsibly, can I say this right here? Remember that God reigns. Somebody ought to shout, God reigns in your house right here. Doesn't matter who is a president right now, God reigns. It doesn't matter who is a president in November, God will still be the king. Somebody shout hallelujah. God says, I reign over your political disturbances. Here is a title that he used for God here. When he talks about the political disturbances, he changes the title of God. Not only is he now the Elohim, but he calls him Lord. He is the Lord of hosts, and he is the God of Jacob. The Lord of hosts means that he is the Lord over all the hosts, all of the stars, the universe, the galaxies. He's the leader of the greatest army. That is, God is the king. I feel like preaching in this place right here. So God is the king. And then not only is he the king, but he's the God of Jacob. So he's a God with universal power, but yet he's a God that is personal. Somebody ought to shout glory in here. Somebody ought to go ahead and tell a neighbor, God reigns. Tell them God reigns. The kingdoms are shaken. The kingdoms are jostling. The parties are jostling. But God reigns above it all. And I invite you to keep your eyes on Jesus. Somebody shout hallelujah. God utters his voice. And the earth melt. What this means is that God has a way that when he speaks his word, power structures have got to be dissolved and replaced by the word of God. He is the Lord of hosts. He's the king of the earth, but he's the God of Jacob. He's the ecclesial king. No matter who comes and who goes, God still protects the destiny of his church. For I heard him say that upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the powers of hell, the gates of hell, shall not prevail against it. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord a praise right there. So he says, pause and think about this for a while here. Contemplate this. Think about the fact that God is the Lord of hosts. He controls everything around us. But even while he controls everything around us, he's still the God of Jacob. He is near to us. He will see us through in our nation. He will see us through in our homes. He will see us through in our hearts. He'll see us through in our communities. He'll see us through in our churches. And so I want to invite somebody. Come here right here. I want to invite somebody right here. As you discern the voice of God, and as you're praying right now, and as you're hearing me, pick your phone up and call 347-862-9261 and says, I want somebody to pray with me right here, because my heart has been fainting for a little bit, but I want to remember and remind myself that God is still in control. Somebody shout hallelujah. I've got to close here. I got one more point left, and I got to get out of here. So God reigns in our palpable distresses. God reigns in our potent disasters and diseases. God reigns in our political disturbances. But here is my last one. Come on, Brother Mark, let's take this home here. God reigns in our personal devotion. And this is where I'm trying to take us to. The reason why God show up in your palpable distresses. The reason God shows up in the potent disasters and diseases. The reason why God stands up above the political disturbances is that God is saying, I'm trying to get your attention because I'm trying to take you to personal devotion. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah right here. Oh yeah. If there's somebody beside you in your house, give him a high five and say, God calls us a personal devotion. God says the place I've been trying to take you all this time is to a personal devotion. He says, come behold the works of the Lord. Call somebody, say, come on and behold the works of the Lord. Come and see what God has done. Come and see how God has brought desolations on the earth. What are you talking about here? What it's saying is, come and see how I've cast down great kings. Come and see how those who rose up to oppress my people, I brought them down low. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Sennacherib, king of Assyria, died, but God still reigns. Antiochus Epiphanes died, but God still reigns. Adolf Hitler died, but God still reigns. Joseph Stalin died, but God still reigns. Saddam Hussein died, but God still reigns. Benito Mussolini died, but God still reigns. Idi Amin died, but God still reigns. The Pharaoh died, but God still reigns. The Spanish flu ended, but God still reigns. Hurricanes have come and gone, but God still reigns. Earthquakes have come and gone, but God still reigns. Volcanoes have come and gone, but God still reigns. Can you see it? Can you remember it? That God allowed those things to live a certain time, but they moved out of the way, but God is still here. Somebody shout, God still reigns. God still reigns. He said, come and behold it. Come and see what I've done. I've made wars the seats of the ends of the earth. I've broken the bow. I've broken the spear asunder. I've burned the chariots in fire. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. In the case of Hezekiah, God sent one angel in one night, and 185,000 Assyrian soldiers were dead. So God says, after you've seen what I can do, he says, be still. I feel like preaching in this place right here. Be still means relax. Desist your actions of trying to help yourself. Stop trying to figure it out. Stop trying to figure out how it's all going to work out. But relax for a while. Don't be anxious. Be calm and confident. Relax in God's presence. Relax in God's power. For God has shown us that God is able to defend his people from disasters and dangers and politicians. Can I preach in this place for a while? He said, know that I am God. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Know that I'm the healer. Know that I'm your provider. Know I'm your way maker. Know I'm your miracle worker. Know I'm your savior. Know I'm the God of all gods. I'm the Lord of all lords. I'm the King of all kings. Know that I am the Lord your God. Somebody shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. But he says, after you pause, after you've looked and you've been still, he says, now I want you to give me devotion. Exalt me in all the earth. Let my name be lifted up. Lift my name in praise. Lift my name in worship. Lift up a song. If you know God's been good to you, why don't you rise up out of your bed right now and put a praise on it? Why don't you rise up out of your bed and say, my hallelujah belong to you, Lord. My glory belong to you. I won't wait till the disasters are over. I won't wait till the distress is gone. I won't wait till the disturbances are gone. But right now, I praise you, for you are God alone. Somebody shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. In the case of Hezekiah, they began to praise God. They said, the Lord of hosts, he is with us. The God of army is here. The Lord of Jacob, he is our refuge. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. But I wonder if there's anybody who's got a song right now. For you know, you've come to the heavenly Mount Zion that cannot be shaken. You've come to the innumerable company of angels. You've come to the power of God. You've come to the place of provision. You've come to your refuge and your strength. And you may not have the song that Hezekiah had, but you want to lift your voice in the middle of COVID, in the middle of confusion, in the middle of global upheaval, and you want to say, we have come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He has never failed us yet. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. He has never failed us. I've got to close in here. I've got to close, but I've got one more point. I've got another song to leave in your spirit as I close out here. And here it is, to everybody whose heart is trembling, to everybody who is wondering what's going on here, to everybody who is saying, is God still in control? To everybody who is wondering if this is the end, I want to say this to you right where you are. Be not dismayed. Whatever betide, because God will take care of you, but beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care. God will. God will. God will. Ooh. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. God reigns. God reigns. Give yourself a high five. Give somebody a high five. Type in the comment section, God still reigns and God is still able. God is still able. If you haven't yet put your life in God's hand, I invite you right now, wait no longer. Tarry no longer. Come right now. Come to the Lord right now. And if you're saying, preacher, I don't know how to do it, pick your phone up. Call 347-862-9261. Somebody is waiting there to pray with you. Somebody's waiting there to pray the distress out of your life. Somebody's waiting there to pray strength inside of you so you can bear whatever comes your way. You can stand underneath the burdens of this life and you can say, I know God reigns, though my distresses are palpable. I know God reigns, even though disease and disasters are upon. I know God reigns, even though disturbance in the political arena. I know God reigns, and I want to have my personal devotion with him because God reigns. Hallelujah. I feel the Holy Ghost. Somebody lift your hand right where you are in your room right now. Hallelujah. I feel the presence and the power of God all across this place, all across this virtual service. God reigns. And God wants somebody just to remember this here, that no matter what comes, hallelujah, the thesis verse is, God is, hallelujah. I could pause right there. God is. Woo! Hallelujah. And then he is our refuge, and he's our strength, and he is our very present help in whatever the trouble looks like. Whatever it sounds like, feels like, God is. And he is our refuge and our strength. Why don't you bow your heads with me right now? Let's pray. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. Oh, we praise you, Most High God. Thank you for a reminder one more time that you reign. And I pray that our response right now is that every knee will bow of everyone who has heard this word of the Lord, and every tongue will confess that you are Lord. You reign. You reign in power. You reign in glory, in majesty, in dominion. And right now you want to reign in somebody's soul, in somebody's life. I ask you right now, do what you do best. Show yourself mighty. Show yourself strong. Even in the forgiveness of somebody's sin right now, as they are confessing it to you, as they're crying out to you, in the middle of somebody's fear, reveal yourself that you are God alone. And you reign. Thank you right now for this word of life. Thank you for the effect that it is having in this virtual space, even right now, for the heart you're touching, for the life you're changing, for the mind you're renewing. Because you reign in power and glory and dominion. Thank you right now, we pray. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let God's people give God praise. God reigns. If you don't have a church home and you want somebody to come alongside with you, you are believing in the Lord right now, and you want somebody to come alongside you in your walk of discipleship, pick up your phone. Call us. 347-862-9261. Or send us an email at prayforme@oneness.nyc. Say, I want to join. Count me in. I want to be a part of this church, this movement. God desires to do something great in your life. He is still your King and your God. God bless you today. Go through your week knowing you serve a God who reigns. God bless you. We love you. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.